Welcome to StormCast, the official Warhammer Age of Sigmar podcast.
I'm Wade Price, and I still get the Total Conquest and Total Commitment battle plans mixed up. Joining me today on StormCast, making a very welcome return to the podcast, is the Warhammer Age of Sigmar custodian himself, Jervis Johnson. Hi, Jervis. Welcome back to StormCast.
Hi, Wade. It's good to be here.
Well, it's been a long year. We're just kind of reflecting, catching up on 2019 and all of the releases for Warhammer Age of Sigmar.
Yes.
And you were our first guest on the newly reforged StormCast about a year or so ago. And it occurred to me that the things that were in your head when we had that first conversation, we've now seen released over the last year. And it's there was a huge amount in there. And you didn't let any of it slip in the podcast. So, well done. Okay. I'll try harder, see if we can get any inkling of what's coming out in 2020. But you must be very proud to see the amount of releases for Warhammer Age of Sigmar in that year.
It's been a great year, but it's been hard work. And we are, the whole team is proud of what we've managed to achieve in the last year, I think. It's you know, a dozen or so Battletomes, Warcry,
yep.
Various box sets, General's Handbook, a White Dwarf article every month and things like that. It's just kept on going and going. But it's been great fun too.
And the Warhammer Age of Sigmar team has grown, I guess, in that time as well, because towards the end of 2018 when we recorded the first StormCast, that was quite a new team. It was newly forged from the Warhammer studio, but that's now grown with more writers, I guess, and other...
We've got a couple more people on the team, and I think really what we've learnt is how everybody else within the team works. It's much more cohesive now and very supportive. It's a great environment to work in. I've been enjoying it a lot. Just this weekend, just gone, we had the open day here at Warhammer World, and so 11 of us, I think, from the team got to go along, and it really does. It feels great. We had our photograph taken all together at the start, and it was a great day. Nice to meet the people who've come along to talk about Age of Sigmar.
Yeah. So, what kind of questions were people asking you at the open day?
Well, they were asking about the new books that are out, the Caradhron, Zinch, and what we're working on at the moment. Of course, we can't tell them that. But they try to find out anyway. And asking about what's it like doing the job, what's the processes that we use, how do we playtest things, and quite often, how do they get to do the job? I always explain that really, being a rules writer, effectively how to play a game. I know how to play a game of Warhammer. And my job is to get that information, those ideas out of my head and into somebody else's so they can play the game too, because I love playing the game and I just want other people to be able to join in. And so you need to learn how to write and be able to get your ideas down on paper in a way that other people could understand, and that's the heart of the job, and that just takes practice. So if you want to be a rules writer, the thing to do is start writing rules. And the best thing to do, start with your local games group, write a battle plan, come up with a new war scroll, take one of the war scrolls we've already done and show how you can make it better. And then whenever we advertise for jobs, we're looking for new rules writers. That's the kind of thing that we'll ask people to do. So if you really want to be a rules writer, that's the way to start. And then the same principle applies to almost all of the other jobs we do, because the team has got photographers, artists, background writers who use much more traditional writing skills, project leaders, figure painters, terrain makers, they're all in there. And with all of those things, you can start honing your own skills and keep on practicing, and then watch out for jobs and come work with us at the studio. Mm.
Do all the other games developers in the team, do they all have experience of having written stuff? We know Sam Pearson had written quite a lot of games before he joined the studio. Is that quite common?
It's quite common, yes. Yeah. Generally, you're going to have had a bit of practice to get through the interview process, really. So you'll have been doing some stuff. I think it's rare for people to actually have to really full-on actually do the job, if you know what I mean, because it's just rare... very specialised field that we're in. There are quite a lot of companies that make computer games. There are very very few that make tabletop games, and even fewer that make tabletop miniature war games, which is what we do. So the opportunity to learn the craft by actually doing it is quite hard. But there are other things that you can do instead and pick up practice. And obviously, if you're going to come and work for Games Workshop, then you've got to love the games, and so you'll be playing the games anyway. And that's pretty good practice.
And the way Games Workshop's changing, growing, seeing the number of different games that have been added to the repertoire, it occurred to me that in times gone by, previous iterations of Warhammer or Warhammer 40,000, there was one game that was almost the sole expression of the background, the IP that we talked about in our first podcast. And now there's lots of different ways of getting into the characters of the different factions and playing. So it must be quite an exciting time for prospective games writers, because there are lots of games that could be made. There are lots of ways of playing with Warhammer models right now, but more that we haven't seen yet, I expect.
Absolutely. I think there will definitely be more things that we can do. I think one of the interesting things that we're starting to discover as a team is that having different scale sorts of games within the range allow us to explore aspects of the background in an appropriate place. I think when we only had one game, if there was something very exciting and interesting in the background, then you tried to shoehorn it into whichever game it was that you were working on. Now that we've got Warcry, that means that there are bits that we can put into the more appropriate to be covered in Warcry. We don't then have to try to invent a rule for some very niche, little nuanced, almost skirmish level kind of thing and include it in Age of Sigmar, because we've got the Warcry game to cover for that. And I think that the other thing that's great about it is that it gives you opportunities to do design work in a different way. We tend to call them the core games, Age of Sigmar, Warhammer 40,000, have a particular kind of the size of the game, the number of miniatures, what the battle plans are like is quite specific. Other game systems allow you to try out different sorts of game mechanics and explore different ideas of what a game can be. And that's exciting when you're basically you love writing rules, as I do, or all of the other aspects. And I think that's an important thing to try and get across here is that when I talk about the Age of Sigmar team, I really do mean it. We're a team. We each bring little different bits to the whole that is the Age of Sigmar hobby. And so when I talk about it, I can express the way that I feel creatively in terms of writing rules, but exactly the same thing applies to Eric taking his photographs, Phil Kelly writing the background, Ben Johnson leading the project, all of those things, and everybody else.
Great stuff. And with the battletomes that we've seen released in 2019, there seems to be a kind of evolution of the thinking. It feels like the sub-factions that we've seen in a number of books where you identify with some of the existing background and there's a colour scheme and that lends itself to some cool rules levers you can play with. There's been, it feels like, an evolution of how those are applied to books, because it's not a one-size-fits-all approach. It's not just a pick a colour scheme, get these rules. There are a number of different developments we saw with Cities of Sigmar where you must take one of those sub-factions, but that then opens up other model possibilities and war scroll possibilities. The Slaves to Darkness has a similar, you must do this, as Archaean would probably tell you, but that lends itself to different army collections as well. But there are still other more familiar sub-factions in the battle times. It must be nice to be able to flex your creative muscles like that and pick the appropriate rules for the background.
Yes, absolutely. I think that the sub-factions, when we're starting work on the rule section of a battle tome, one of the first things that we do is have what we call a play styles meeting. And really what we're trying to do, identify there is different ways that you might want to use the models for that army. And the inspiration for that usually comes from the models themselves, but also come from the background too. So we've got interesting bits in the background. We'll look at those. But generally what we'll do is we'll say, we've got this miniatures range. If I was collecting an army, what would look cool? What would I want to be able to collect? And then we use that as a springboard to say, okay, well, within the sub-factions, the artifacts of power and the rules that we've got in the book, what we'll try to do is make sure that if you take a certain combination of them, that will allow you to collect an army in that that looks like that and feel that it performs well on the tabletop. So if you want to have an army that's got, like for the Caradron, a lot of ships in it, then that's a play style. It might be that you want to have lots of frigates, it might be that you want to have lots of gun haulers, so we'll look at those things, and some of the sub-factions allow you to take those the frigates or gun haulers as battle line units in your army, so you can basically concentrate on the ships. And then have auxiliary infantry units. On the other hand, you might want to have an army that's all about the chemists and that aspect of things. Mm. And we can then build a sub-faction that allows you to build on that and do that kind of thing. That ability to first of all to identify the different ways that you can play and articulate the army and then include them in the book hopefully means that when you get your battle tome, there's not just one way to play it, there are lots of different ways and you get to pick the one that suits yourself.
Mm-hmm. And we see that as well in the General's Handbook, because another edition of the General's Handbook released in 2019, and that includes loads of great demonstrations, I think, of other ways that you could play. And it's very apparent, I think, that the matched play, the fair play, the aspect, the idea that you could turn up and play a game of Warhammer Age of Sigmar with a complete stranger on the other side of the world using the core rules that you'd be both familiar with, and you'd have a fair game. But if you wanted to have wildly unbalanced forces or even randomly generated forces, I think that's a lovely callback to the tables and Rogue Trader and the Realm of Chaos books when I started in the hobby. Those ideas are in the General's Handbook for people who want to do those sorts of things, and if you've never really considered it, there is an expression, a demonstration of what that could look like. I think it must be nice again to be able to scratch those itches if you want to come up with more narratively informed or randomly determined games, just to see how that would go down.
No, absolutely. I think that, I mean, it's no secret that I love narrative based games and campaign games, and so having the chance to explain to other people what I like about it by writing down cool rules that hopefully encourage people to do it is great. But I think it's also important that what we do is we make it clear to people that the really exciting thing about the Age of Sigmar hobby is that you get to tailor it to suit your own tastes. It's not, you're not locked in to playing the game in any one particular way. You can get under the hood and tinker with the game system as much as you like, to be perfectly honest, as much as the other people you play games with like too. The having open narrative match play really allowed us to start exploring those different ideas rather than trying to homogenize them all together, which is what we did in the past. We knew that there were lots of different ways to play, but we tried to just get one set of rules to cover everything. And I think that with Age of Sigmar, we started to realize that actually, no, that we're better off saying, no, these are different things. We're going to present the three ways to play. Now, that's on the understanding that you can cherry pick across all three of them. And I know that there are plenty of people who absolutely love doing narrative campaigns and things, but they'll still use the points values out of the match play section because it makes it much easier to pick an army. By the same token, there are people who run tournaments who really like some of the the ruses or the special rules that you'll find in the narrative play section. I think that's just cool. I want to include that. So they'll set their tournament up to incorporate those things in.
Is that very rewarding to see those out in the wild?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely it is. It's one of my favourite things, actually, is going along to Warhammer World when there's a tournament taking place. And it's just that bit, just about 5 minutes in, after a round starts, and you look out across the hall and everybody is like their heads down, kind of at the table, they're talking to their opponent, they're doing stuff at the table. And the entire hall is doing it, so you've got 150, however many people it is in there, and you go, that's my fault, at least partially, that they're all doing that. That's a fantastic feeling. It's difficult to describe. It's both empowering and humbling at the same time.
Fantastic. Yeah. Something else I wanted to ask you about from the General's Handbook was the meeting engagements, because I felt like that was a project that you'd been working on for a little while, and that's another way of capturing everything that's great about Warhammer, but presenting it in a slightly smaller playing area or number of minutes that you'd need to play the game, amount of time required to play the game. Was that quite a development of the core Age of Sigmar game system as well?
It was. I think that was one of the most interesting projects that I've worked on over the last year, and it really started out as kind of saying that, well, a game is designed to be played in a certain space. And most of the games assume that space is 6x4, quite large, really. Mm. And with 2,000-point armies, that's it's kind of the standard view. But that's quite large. And in particular, if you're playing at home, you've only got a dining table, then that's difficult to achieve. So could we say, well, let's change the parameters in the environment. We want the game to be just as interesting, just as challenging, but you can play it on a dining table. You can play it to a conclusion in a couple of hours, mm-hmm. With a 1,000-point army instead. And so the questions came first, and then the design came after that. So I knew that the playing area needed to be a certain size. In the end, we decided to say, well, why don't we just assume it's around about the area of four Warcry boards. That gave us a good size to work with. I knew that the armies, we wanted them to be 1,000 points, because that gives you enough space to kind of like do some interesting army builds. And then once I started to put the armies down on that surface, what you quickly found was that if you just say, well, I'm just going to scale everything down, you end up with this little tiny area to fight over in the middle, because you need about 12 inches on each side for the armies to set up. So that clearly wasn't going to work. So I started to reduce the deployment area and effectively try to make it so that in a normal pitched battle on a 6x4 table, you'll have about 24 inches between each side's territories, as a rule of thumb. I wanted to there be more or less that same distance, so the game wouldn't feel that different. You've got the same manoeuvre area, you've got the same fighting area in the game. That left me with only a little bit of room to set the armies up in. And that led to two things. First of all, it led to me sort of saying, well, it's okay to set up a model with its base overlapping a little tiny bit, just so that we didn't have to worry about models that were on gigantic, huge bases not fitting into the deployment area. But it also encouraged me to look at splitting the armies up into three contingents that arrive over the course of three turns. And that meant that on turn one, you had plenty of space to set the army up. Once we'd done those, most of the design work had been done, but it came out of looking at the space that the game was going to be played in, and it created a game that was different to a pitched battle. And I found really quite interestingly different. Mm. The tactics you use, it isn't just scale down pitched battle, you've got to use different tactics. The way you pick an army becomes different because of the way that the contingents are split up. The way that the battle plans work changes as well, the way that we place the objectives and stuff. We needed to be careful that they were placed not too close to the edges, basically, is what we found. Because if they were too close to the edges, it created strange situations when new units started to arrive during the game. And at the end of it, we ended up with this great system where you can play games quite quickly. You can do a tournament in a single day if you want to, but you can also have a real different set of challenges. Mm. And for me as a designer, that was very satisfying. And I think that what it also opened up was a saying, well, actually, we should think about this more and harder. What are different kind of formats that we can use for match play games, so that people don't just think that match play equals pitched battles. Yeah. What they think is match play means a kind of competitive game, a pickup game that mm-hmm. you can play down at the club or at home, but that is primarily a contest. But actually, the way that you do that can vary quite a lot and give you lots of interesting different ways to play just in that one little way to play.
Mm-hmm. And it's a nice building block towards a larger army if you wanted it to be. People have used those meeting engagement 1,000-point lists to move towards the pitch battle list, but there'll be plenty of other people who will get into playing meeting engagements and see different tactical challenges that there would be in a pitched battle and different battle plans, and find something to play around with in there.
Yeah, well, I think that's definitely what I want. One of the things that I wanted with meeting engagement was to be enough there that you could live in that game, if you see what I mean. That it wasn't a stepping stone towards playing a pitched battle game. That it was an end in itself. That then also happened to be something you can go backwards and forwards to. And I think it's possible to sometimes to look at the hobby as being a bit like, kind of like it's a linear kind of thing. You start off with one unit, then you've got two, then you've got, and you keep on going until you've got these huge armies and the table, and you fight enormous battles. So that's kind of like a straight line trajectory. And I don't think the hobby really is a straight line like that. Well, I tend to think of it a bit more like the circle line in the London Tube, which is a circle, as you would expect, with lots of stops on it. With the hobby, what you can do is you can move backwards and forwards around that circle. You can get out at different destinations, and it might be that you decide that you want to go to meeting, the meeting engagement stop, and that's it, that you're really happy. But actually, that's not the only place you can go. You can go forwards, you can go sort of like clockwise round to pitch battles. You might want to move counterclockwise back to Warcry and then keep on moving around and doing different things and keeping on exploring that. So what you get is lots of different destinations of the hobby, none of which are the last destination.
And I guess having seen now another expression of what matched play could look like, that can start prompting other ideas from the team of how else, what other collections of models it might be interesting to play around with, and what other sorts of competitions could be set up using those miniatures.
Yeah.
It seems as well, hearing you talking about the playing area for the meeting engagement variant, that would be an interesting thing to consider, going back to the idea of prospective games developers or people wanting to write rules, knowing where that game is going to be played. Just coming up with a very abstract, wonderful rule system that is mathematically sound might not be everything that you need to create the game. That's not everything you need to consider.
Yeah. No, that's absolutely true. I think that the you've always got to imagine the environment a game's going to be played in and the people who are playing it too. If you want to do the job professionally, you're never designing for yourself. You're always designing for other people. But there's more to it than that. I think it's about kind of being able to have a clear idea of what the goal is that you're trying to achieve with some of the design that you're doing. And that's why I find it particularly useful to kind of give myself a kind of visual set of parameters, as it were, saying, like, okay, it's going to be about this big, this many models. But the goals can be different to that as well. You can they can be the mechanics that you're going to use. You might be wanting to explore a particular kind of like way of putting together an army. You can be looking at wanting to do a campaign system. You can be looking at wanting to do an aerial combat game. So in White Dwarf just recently, we had took some rules that I'd written before for aerial combat for 40K and applied them to Age of Sigmar because doing all the work on the Caradhran book just really made us think about boats and flying things and stuff like that. I thought, well, wouldn't it be cool just to be able to just play games based on that?
Mm-hmm. And was that the I've forgotten the name now of the 40K combat, the aerial combat game that we had.
Stormcloud Attack.
Stormcloud Attack.
Was the 40K version.
That, there's a great elegant rule system there, isn't there? It wasn't a system specifically for the aircraft of the 41st millennium. They were just the most suitable models to use in a 40K game system. But it's a very transferable engine, I would imagine. Did it require much modification to get it into White Dwarf?
No. Surprisingly little, really. It was, I think the way that damage worked needed to be a bit different, because with Age of Sigmar, it's much more about close combat. And obviously with 40K, it was mostly about shooting.
Yep.
There were some changes to the ranges and how you could attack hand to hand, really, and that was about it. The rest of it came together very quickly. Aerial combat as a subject is something I've always been interested in ever since I was young. And so I've read quite a lot about it, so I had a kind of idea in my head, and I've played games of aerial combat over the years, and I think you're always trying to find something a little bit different. It's relatively straightforward to come up with a design which is takes an established system and just then gives it a skin of 40K and so on. It's more fun to kind of say, well, okay, I know the other ones that are out there. What can I do that's a little bit different? What do I want to try and kind of like add to that? stuff. And Stormcloud Attacks was me looking at the ways that the models worked, the size of the playing area, but also using the dice and the bases in the game. I really enjoyed that kind of idea that you could use them by the base and use them to measure the moves and use the base to measure the moves and things like that. It all came together very nicely and felt quite different to anything else that I'd played.
And it sounds like you've got quite cinematic imagery in your head, maybe to try to get out when you're talking about the aerial combat of the 41st millennium, being dogfighting and shooting, and then in the Mortal Realms, there'd probably be more hand-to-hand combat. I remember you bringing in a book in the studio of First World War aces dueling and with pistols drawn, fighting from their planes. So you'd have that kind of cutlasses with the Caradron boarding actions, and those are the qualities that you want to evoke, yeah, I imagine.
Absolutely. I think you... there's nothing new that you ever create. Obviously, what you do is you draw on stuff and then you reimagine it and you make it extraordinary for Age of Sigmar. But there are lots of fascinating things that can act as an inspiration for stuff that you do in the design that you're working on. And I think for myself, I enjoy lots of aspects to do with gaming. So I can get completely kind of like interested in quite abstract notions to do with games design. So the maths of the way that the dice go together and things like that can disappear down that rabbit hole quite quickly. And elegant little mechanics are things that appeal to me. But I try to keep in mind that particularly for a miniature war game, it's a very immersive experience. If you're doing it right, then what should happen with the players is that they can, to an extent, suspend their disbelief and imagine that what's unfolding is a battle. And that's your goal, is to make that possible. Now, you want it to be challenging, so you're also engaging the bit of that makes you feel like I'm a clever general. Because that's mixed in there,
yeah,
as well with the immersion, if that makes sense.
Yep.
It makes you feel, it's satisfying because you feel, well, I won because I was clever or lucky. but it also, I think in a strange kind of way, kind of like engages you with the fiction of the game, that you are the general in command of an army. And then you get the very visceral kind of like things, the combats, the individual fights that are going on the battlefield itself, that really sometimes I could just imagine it. Yeah, I could just imagine what was going on there. It was like a great movie or a great TV series or a great book.
The way you were describing the opening scene of a Warhammer battle, I guess, the 24 inches away as the battle lines are drawing together in that first charge. And as you say, with meeting engagements, it's the same quality. It's just the camera's maybe narrowed in a little bit. It's the same huge battle lines, might be fighting, but the action is just concentrating on a smaller area.
I think with pitch battle and meeting engagement, I think there's a slightly different story going on with each of them. So pitch battle is absolutely that thing. The mighty armies are lined up and you've got them facing each other. So you form your line of battle, basically, almost all of those games. And it's a proper kind of like head-to-head fight going on there. Whereas meeting engagement is more of you've got some of the guys stumble across an enemy and get drawn into a fight, and then more people turn up, and then more people turn up. So the story is quite different, I think, in a way. It's that kind of surprise encounter, almost.
It does have a lovely dynamic, the visuals, the imagery of a cavalry reinforcement arriving from the flank. I think that can imagine players who are cherry-picking elements of the games that they like to stitch together for themselves could employ that in pitched battles, that notion of sweeping reinforcements turning up from one side or the other. I'm sure there are people out there experimenting with the rules that you've put in the General's Handbook to see if there's something in there.
Yeah, for sure.
So we've talked a little bit about Warcry, touched on Warcry. That's another great expression of ways to play with Citadel miniatures that don't command the same amount of table space or demands on your time as a pitched battle. And you were involved in some of the early work on Warcry, were you?
I was. I did the initial R&D, so I got 2 whole weeks to come up with a cool idea for a skirmish game, which was great, actually. It was just because what I got to do was all the fun stuff and then leave it to poor old Sam to actually tidy everything up at the end. But I found it a really interesting project because I love skirmish games. Necromunda is one of my favourite games. Obviously, Blood Bowl I designed myself, and that's kind of a skirmish game. Mm-hmm. Just poor innocent footballers get caught in the middle, but yeah, really it's war. We all know it. Yeah. And so I was very interested with the idea of creating a skirmish game, again, kind of like doing something a little bit different that hadn't really been seen before. Mm. So I was keen that it had a little kind of like a cool little mechanic in there that was a little bit different and that gave us an opportunity to show the differences between the units. And that's really where the idea of rolling dice and getting double combos came from. I was looking around at different things and I designed a game which I originally designed to take along to game shows. So I had a game that I could play in 5 minutes if it got quiet, because sometimes you go to a game show and there aren't all that many people there. And so you trap somebody at the table with you and say, look, I'll teach you how to play this game. And it involved rolling 5 dice and using the dice to then move miniatures along columns. And it was about the pre-battle scouting that went on before a battle took place. So I remembered that, and I remembered that one of the things from it was rolling the dice and then looking for combinations of dice. I thought, well, maybe I can repurpose that. Mm. And that was really the starting point for the Warcry system. I took that, I tried it out, and it quickly became obvious that, yeah, this is going to work. It was satisfying rolling the dice at the start of the turn. People enjoyed the combos, and then the combos gave us the opportunity to give each model a cool, special, unique thing that it could do that other people couldn't. It also gave you interesting resource management questions. You have to decide how you're going to spend the combos that you've got, and that was an interesting little tactical conundrum there. Interestingly, when I was doing that, I had been working on meeting engagement, and so I'd already got in my head this idea of the three different contingents coming in from different edges. So I thought, oh, maybe I can borrow that idea. So I borrowed a couple of my own ideas, as it were, in this particular case, and incorporated that in because I really liked the way that, if you're not careful with the skirmish game, it can involve boiled down pretty much to you keep all the models together as a group and then you go over and beat up the opponent's group of models. By spreading them around, and I knew this had come up in the meeting engagement games, you get lots of little fights happening in lots of different locations, which is much more interesting, I think, than just one big fight in the middle of the battlefield. Mm. And so that, combined with the objectives for the games, gave a lot of movement, and it was exciting waiting for the reinforcements to turn up. And also it made kind of like selecting which contingent, which group you were going to put the models in quite interesting. So I was very pleased with all of those things. When I was working on the game, all I needed to worry about was we had some concepts and some rough, they're called renders, little kind of like resin prototypes of the models that were going to be in there, so that was very exciting. But I only had two warbands to worry about, so it was easy to come up with the rules and make them a little bit different. And then hand on all of the rest of the work to Sam to do. But I think that the other thing that I was really interested in with Warcry was the campaign system, because for me, Blood Bowl, Necromunda, Mordheim is about the campaign, the way that you link the games together. Now, the campaign system that we used in those games started off in Blood Bowl, as I remember, basically as a kind of a league system, and then moved on to Necromunda and then Mordheim. And I like that system. I've got a lot of time for it. But I knew that it has a kind of like a tendency to kind of like you get what's called runaway leader syndrome. If somebody does well, they can become so powerful that really in the end all they can do is retire or everybody else quits. And then you start the campaign again. So I was interested in having something where that didn't really come up. And I was also interested in the idea that the campaign would be a personal thing, that you could kind of do your own little campaign, play games of Warcry to help you move along. And so the Warcry campaign system kind of like grew out of looking at those things. So the background that was being developed for Warcry was very much about the Varan Spire and the area and these warbands travelling through it, and that kind of led me towards thinking, well, there's a map, and that could be an interesting idea. Maybe I can work my way along the map and do things on that, and that seemed very appropriate and rather fun. And I thought, well, if you each have your own map, then that's cool, isn't it? So, because one of the problems with map campaigns, if everybody's on the same map, it gets messy, complicated quite quickly. Mm. And also you have to rely on everybody else to, you know, turn up and do things and be there and available, whereas if I could avoid that, then I knew that as long as you could find somebody to play a game with, you were going to be able to move the story of your warband on, and it became your own little personal quest. And that really appealed to me again, because I think that a lot of the great fantasy stories are about that idea of the journey. Lord of the Rings is probably the most famous example of that. It's all about the journey. And so having Warcry be about the journey of your warband and actually you'd be able to see the journey was exciting.
Yeah.
And then we could use that to kind of like sort of leverage that a bit so that your warband didn't get that much better, because it didn't need to kind of like get the progression that you got in Necromunda and Blood Bowl, where you're really looking at making your Blood Bowl team or your band tougher. More effective, because you'd got a different objective that you were trying to achieve. So you got something out of playing games. It wasn't necessarily just, well, my guy's got +1 to hit from now on, although that was an element too, mm-hmm. of what you could do. And again, I just managed to get enough down, one map, and enough games in to kind of show the proof of concept, and then dump all of the stuff on poor old Sam, who then took it off and did all of the work that he's done since then, and really took those basic ideas and made them sing.
Mm.
And added quite a few ideas of his own along the way.
Have you had any further involvement in it, or has it been all Sam?
All Sam, really. I'd love to have been more involved. I really would. Though I would love to be more involved in everything that Games Workshop does, and you can't. There's too much stuff. And especially last year for Age of Sigmar, there were so many battle tomes and other things that were going on that really I could afford the 2 weeks. And then I needed to kind of say, okay, right, that's it. I have to hand that baton on. I trust and respect Sam and know that he's going to do a great job with those things. I got to pay attention to the things that I need to worry about, which is like these new battle tomes that are coming along. I'm what's called the chief custodian of the custodian, not the chief custodian, the custodian of the Age of Sigmar rules. So it meant that it means that I need to look at that the overall shape of the game system for Age of Sigmar and how it's all hanging together. So I needed to be able to focus on that, and make sure that we were getting better at being consistent in the way that we write the rules, improve the playtesting and calculator system as best we can to make the balance better, and then write dwarf articles about it, and make sure that we didn't get overly focused just on match play, because it's very easy to just end up concentrating all of your time on that, because it's such a powerful part of the hobby. So that was quite enough to keep me busy, and left Sam to beaver away and do all the amazing stuff that he's done so far and will be doing
absolutely
over the coming months.
And within the campaign, I was thinking of games like Mordheim and Necromunda, even when it came down to how many credits or bits of gold or weirdstone you would find, there'd be lots of dice rolls and it would be very random. So even before you get to the notion of the members of the warband becoming more experienced or more proficient or getting new war gear, there was a lot of random elements in the very small degrees of detail in which your warbands could improve. And it feels like a lot of that's been removed as well, to make sure everyone has a good time. Like, you will get better from playing the game. Everybody, I remember you talking a while ago about the notion of get something. You play the game, everyone gets something. So there's a progression to be made. So you feel like you're moving along at that same rate, and that avoids that runaway leader syndrome. But you still got a sense of the world. And I think when I think of games like Necromunda and Mordheim, they were blessed in having a setting that had a currency that everybody used. And that doesn't really obtain. And in the Bloodwind Spoil, because it's a barter economy, gold isn't worth what it was in the old world, in the mortal realms. So I think it must be exciting for the studios to be show but not telling what happens in these worlds, doing a bit more world building by having the opportunity just to suggest what life might be like in a little part of the Varen Spire, but it doesn't commit you necessarily.
And I have to say that I think with Warcry, one of the most exciting things about it is the way that it starts to lift the curtain on the areas of the mortal realms that have been conquered by chaos, because the vast majority of the mortal realms have been overrun by chaos. But what we've seen in a lot of the stuff that we've been writing about it is the battle lines, the front line. Warcry starts to kind of like say, well, no, there are cities. Chaos works as a civilization. Mm-hmm. People live there. I think that we were able to draw a certain amount of inspiration for the work that had been done in the old world for the Norse in particular and the Chaos Wastes, of this idea of that it's a chaos land, but people live in it, and so you've got to be able to understand how they live in it, what their motivations are, because otherwise it seems almost inexplicable as to why would you worship the chaos gods. Mm. But actually there are good reasons for it, and I think that the war cry and the background that's been done on all of those different war bands starts to show that it's much more multifaceted, more interesting, and rather deeper, and can work as a dangerous, rather intimidating society, but it will hold together a society too. And so you can imagine that if the mortal realms were completely conquered by chaos, it would still function. Mm. People would still live there. And that was extremely exciting to work on. I think you kind of like, you get bits like that in almost every project that you do. Obviously my focus is the rules, but a lot of the rules are inspired by the background. And in addition, a lot of the discussions you have are with the miniature designers and the background writers who are working full time on these aspects of things. And you get a chance to kind of stick your oar in occasionally and say, I think wouldn't it be cool if it was a bit like this? And we were definitely able to do that a bit with Warcry. Mm. So that it's kind of like it's a two-way street, the conversation. I don't know, it's difficult to describe. It's a very satisfying part of the hobby. And one that you go home at the end of the day and say, that was a good day's work there, basically. You know, and it could be that you managed to figure out how to write the rule for something, but just as often it's like, yeah, well, I went to the play styles meeting. I got an example of this, okay. There was a play styles meeting where we were having, I can't remember for which army it was now, I think it might have been the Iron Jaws, I'm going to say, but I'm not quite sure. Anyway, one of the play styles we thought was, this army has a lot of heroes in it. Wouldn't it be interesting if there was a play style which was kind of like, we called it the Magnificent Seven in the end, but yeah, basically a bunch of heroes. We'll create something that allows you to do that, because that would be fun, because then as a collector what you can do is just buy those hero models that are cool and play games with mm-hmm. them, which is great, and I'd want to do that. Mm. I think it's just as an idea. But that sparked the question, well, why? What's happening in real life, if that makes sense? And it created a really interesting discussion with the background writers in there about saying, well, actually, what does it tell us about the background for the race? What's happening here? Why are these warriors gathering together and doing this thing? What motivates them to do it? Why is it an important aspect of the background? And it let and so those ideas seeded some stuff that the background writers were then able to develop in the background section of the book and add into the thing. But it came from kind of like, I want to collect seven of those guys, you know, because I think that will look really cool and that would be a fun game, wouldn't it? And so you have conversations like that, and then at the end of the day you go, I think that was fun. You get so much more out of it than just, okay, you can pick any seven heroes and use them as an army.
Well, it helps with that immersion, I guess, for the future, doesn't it? Because if then the background, and then that will probably inform the artwork and the photography, and if every aspect of whichever battle time it might be tells you that this is a feature, this is something that obtains with these armies, it feels natural and believable. And if you want to get into character, if you like to play narratively, or if you like to make decisions for your models based on what you think your commander would think, you have more of an in to having that understanding.
Yes. It's interesting. I'm going off to a slight tangent, if
please,
that's okay. Because obviously the Caradron book's come out just recently. I think this is the second edition of the Caradron book. And doing the first edition is always difficult. Yeah. And one of the things that we'd found was that when the book first came out, we were cautious about how powerful we made the ironclads and the frigates, because we didn't want them to totally dominate the game. But we probably went a bit too far. And so over time, what happened was the points values for them came down to reflect their effectiveness within the game. But our feeling was that actually these are big centerpiece models. They look and should be a very important part of your army. And so the points values we'd initially given those things seemed to be the right one. So when we started working on the second edition of the book, one of the things that we said was, well, really what we want to do, what can we do to make the Ironclad worth the amount of points we initially charged for it? Because that was the right weight for that model within the game and within the background for the Caradron as well. And then out of that came a kind of like a feeling, well, really, you know, what we've got to try and do here is make sure that that the heart of a Caradron army are the ships, that's the place you look to. There are other options, don't get me wrong. You don't have to take ships in a Caradron army if you don't want to, but we really wanted to put them kind of right at the centre of it, and that comes out of the of us kind of looking at the army and saying, well, obviously it plays well, and what we could do is just tweak what's already there, adjust some of the points values, do a little bit of work on the internal balance, and jobs are gooden. But the armies that we were seeing didn't reflect the background as it was written, and we liked the background as it was written. So what we've tried to do this time around is finesse and work on the army list so that the rules support you using an army that looks like a Caradron army in the game.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an underpinning thing for almost all of the books that we work on. Yeah, the we don't design the armies to just to basically to be able to win games, if that makes sense. We design them to be a reflection of the background that are enjoyable to use in games.
Some people just want to play games to tell stories. They're not necessarily looking to win the game. They just want to, like you say, like playing games and to experience the game.
Absolutely. But I think the other thing is that there are plenty of people who love winning games, and that's their primary driver. And then for them, what you want to do is say, well, what they can do is they can do that, and they're using an army that they know looks right. Because I think that sometimes people who want to do well at a game think, well, everybody's telling me that I should take these units, and so I will, even though it feels a little bit wrong to me. And it doesn't feel quite right, but I'll do it because I want to be competitive. And so it's our job to say, no, you can have both of these things. You can have a nice, like army to use. It's going to be competitive, but it also reflects what you've read about the army. Looks like an army should look for that race. And that's what we try to achieve. It's hard, though. The detail of that is hard, and that's why we now have these review processes, a couple of times a year, and keep on looking at it, keep on working at it, keep on nudging things in the direction. But when people wonder about what our primary driver is, it's to say, well, we want an army that's fun to play in the game but reflects the background for the army itself, so it looks like a proper army as much as we possibly can.
So having mentioned there was a previous Caradron Overlord's Battletome, were you filing away feedback and observations and notes on the Caradron up until working on this later project?
We were. You get quite a lot of feedback all the time. But in addition, some of our playtesters, our external playtesters, good and very dedicated Caradron players, so they let us know what they wanted to see in the book. And then I think that what we added to that was that kind of like desire to kind of like look back at the original background and try and move that as a central aspect for the book as we could. So that meant we surprised the playtesters with some of the things that we'd decided to do. But once they got into it, they really enjoyed it and gave invaluable feedback, obviously, about how the army actually worked. But it's an interesting conversation again, and that kind of thing.
And one of the points to make with the three ways to play, I think, is that it's not a decision for life. You don't decide that you are one of these three types of player. Any given game you might play might lean towards one or more of those headings than the other.
Absolutely.
But it seems like the desire to enable hobbyists to build up the collections of models they love, but have a number of different levers they can pull for putting them on the table and evoking different feelings or having different cinematic responses or bits of imagination going on.
Yeah, well, I know that there are some people who say, I like the models, but it's not. I'm really here to play the game, and I understand that. I think it's true up to a point, but on the other hand, I do think that if that everybody who takes part in this hobby on some level likes the miniatures. Mm. Yeah, they really do. What they'd rather have is the miniatures they really like in their army, in the best of all possible worlds. And we try to make it so that you can be guided to a fairly large extent by your aesthetic appreciation of the miniatures, and that should give you a good army to play with. And we keep on trying to home in on that target.
Mm-hmm. We discussed in the first podcast that one of the objectives, I think, with Age of Sigmar was making sure every unit, every war scroll, has a defined role, has a purpose. Mm-hmm. So you shouldn't feel like Unit X is just a worse unit or a more expensive version of Unit Y. The different units will have different roles and responsibilities. So if you like the look of them, you should certainly collect them, because they will have application in your games at some point.
Yes, oh, absolutely. And I think that, okay, I think the detail of that can get complicated. Mm-hmm. You know, if you've got an army with lots and lots of units in, giving each of them a little niche and a role to play can be quite difficult. But that's where the playstyle meetings helps quite a lot, because it means that what we can do is we can say, well, this unit might be not the most optimal choice if you've got this style of army. But in this style of army, it's really going to have its day in the sun. And that helps make the choice of what you're picking much more, much broader, I think. From experience, we know that I call it homing on the target. So games design is primarily, it's what's called an iterative process, which means that you write something, you test it, you rewrite it, you test it, you rewrite it, you test it, and you keep on going round that circle for as long as you possibly can. And it never, ever ends. So, and you can see that with the books. It's why the second edition of the Caradhron book is a lot better than the first, because we've been able to go through more iterations. So we always get the opportunity to improve things, and that's so we have our goal in mind, and then we just try to our best to get there.
I think one of the features of Age of Sigmar I've seen an awful lot of hobbyists excited about is the fact that in older days of Warhammer, you might feel that there was one army book in the edition of your game system, which might be 4 years or so. So you might get a new army book every 8 years. It might be 8 years between one army book and the next iteration of your army book, and there's been a lot more change in Age of Sigmar, and people have seen updates to their rules and the opportunity for the rules team to tinker with them, look at points values, make those updated. Also, the General's Handbook, it feels like it's given you the option to add a few more cool core rules in, because we saw those new command abilities for pitched battle games, which is a new wrinkle that everybody can play around, or a new lever that everybody can make use of in their games. So it must be good for you as a games designer to have that opportunity to tinker with the game itself as well.
I think it's definitely improved things, made life more straightforward for us games designers, because we get that chance to go back. I think it's provided us also with another interesting challenge, because what you have to do is you've got to show restraint. What we try to do is nudge things as much as we can when we're looking at the updates that we do in the General's Handbook and after the release of a book, because the worst possible thing would be to kind of like shove it too far. So and I think what we're aware of is that we're in here for the long haul. I think that sometimes people can, and especially in this modern day and age, I mean, it's the feedback is so quick. With the internet and things that you can do, that that it kind of fuels like a week seems like a very long time. You know, 6 months can seem like forever, but actually, Games Workshop is our plan goes far beyond 6 months. What we're looking at with Age of Sigmar is years and years ahead, and we're going to keep on working away at those books, and we're going to keep on improving them. So that iterative process I was talking about earlier on is one that is going to be going on for decades, basically, and not stop. So we kind of, that means that we can afford to take our time a little bit. We can be cautious. Mm-hmm. We can listen to what people are saying. We can make improvements and then say, is that enough? Not quite. Okay, we'll do a bit more this time.
Good stuff.
And then we know that we'll be getting back fairly soon. Mm. To that, to have another go if it's needed.
Very reassuring to hear. Great stuff. And we're also going to talk on a bit of a tangent again on another game that you've been involved in, Warhammer Quest. So that's currently in a kind of 40k incarnation, Warhammer Quest Blackstone Fortress, but you were involved in the design of that.
I was.
Previous
yes.
editions of Warhammer Quest, yep. Even back as far as Advanced Hero Quest.
Advanced Hero Quest, it's one of the, I don't know, something like the second or third project I ever worked on.
Really?
It was. Basically, at the time, Hero Quest came out, which was a very popular game. It was produced by a company called Hasbro. And we provided the miniatures for it and a lot of the artwork. And in return, apart from the promotion and stuff and the fact that our name has appeared on the box, which was very helpful, we got the right to do the advanced version of the game. And that was the job that I got. And that was I found that very interesting. It was a very different kind of game to Warhammer or 40K, or even a game like Necromunda or Blood Bowl, because it's basically a role-playing game. And I love role-playing games. I started playing D&D when I was 14. White Box, original version. Yeah. In the years that came along after that, I was privileged to play quite a few games of Dungeons & Dragons with some very good dungeon masters, including one who was the editor of White Dwarf magazine for quite a while back in the early days. Albi Fiori was an amazing dungeon master. So I learned things from him and tried to incorporate them in to Advanced Hero Quest as best I could back then. And it means that I've always been interested in role-playing games, so I keep an eye on what's happening. I get to play role-playing games every now and then, but I'm just fascinated by the process. And within Games Workshop, Warhammer Quest is the opportunity to explore that side of gaming. I did Advanced Hero Quest. I helped with Warhammer Quest and Silver Tower, and then Shadows Over Hammerhall. I got to design. So it was I got to for the first time since Advanced Hero Quest about sort of like what, however many, a long time ago, 20 years before or something like that. It must have been. I got to design the game from scratch and incorporate in a number of ideas and things that I was interested in. And then after that, Blackstone Fortress came along. And really, by then, I was the custodian for Age of Sigmar. I probably should have said, I shall hand this baton on, but I couldn't resist.
It's got one quest on the box.
And Blackstone Fortress, again, I took you. I'm going to start sound like a stuck record here with the iterative process thing, but you learn all the time as you're going along. And so I'd learned quite a lot from having worked on Shadows. And there were some things that I was very interested to try to incorporate into Blackstone Fortress. In particular, I thought that we could improve the AI, the artificial intelligence of the monsters, of the bad guys in there. In Shadows, they tend to basically run at you and then hit you, which is fine, but it was a little bit limiting and tactically meant that the fights were kind of like just bash into each other. And so I wanted to do something that could make the fights feel a bit more tactical and make it feel there's an idea that you see being mentioned occasionally called emergent intelligence, which is that you have something which effectively is being generated randomly, but after a while appears to me like there's some intelligence going on behind it. And so I wanted to see whether I could incorporate that in with the monsters, and that's really where the idea of having a little chart that you get with the game, so you kind of look up the situation that the monster's in and then roll a dice on a column and it will tell you what it does. And within that I was able to kind of build in little strategies that the monsters would use. So there'd be some that would, if they were in hiding, would sneak up on you and then pounce on you and then run back to being in hiding again. And other ones would just kind of like come straight at you. I think the ones that I particularly enjoyed were the psychers. I'm going to forget the name of them. within the game, where there's bad guys on the other side. And these ones, what they do is they just stay hiding, doing bad things to you with their powers of their mind. So you've actually got to go and hunt them down. So it created an interesting tactical situation where instead of the heroes kind of like being confronted by monsters that were attacking them in waves, they'd got some that were hanging out at the back, kind of like zapping them with mind bolts. Other ones that were coming straight at them, and other ones that were taking cover and shooting at them, and other ones that were trying to sneak around behind them and pounce on them from the shadows, which I thought was satisfying and interesting and made the actual fights kind of like cool. So I got that, and again, and the other thing that I got was the idea of it's going to sound silly, how you pack the game down. I was, being able to pause a game and then restart it, I felt was an important part of these games. So they're quite long. You're playing a campaign, generally. It's a role-playing. So for me, role-playing games are a regular group of people. They get together and you link the games together and you play over the course of several sessions. You'll go through an adventure. I wanted that to be part of the game, but a board game, particularly the types of games that we do, they have lots of bits and pieces and moving parts. So how you so creating it so you could play a game, do the little skirmishes, and then easily stop, pack the game down, and then at the next session unpack everything and do things was an important part of the design process. And led to the little plastic sleeves that you put your heroes and all the bits and pieces in. That worked out nicely. It took us a little while to get there. We had a few false starts and pieces of paper with stuff written down on it and things before we thought there might be an easier way of doing this. You get stuff like that can be kind of fun because what you can, it's easy to say as a games designer, what I want is little plastic envelopes that we can put the things in and then just dump that onto our poor long-suffering specs guys, basically, who have to go out and actually find the components, figure out how they can get them made, printed, look cool, and then back again over in time for us to put them in the boxes so that everybody can get the bits and pieces that we wanted. So I had that. I was also interested. There are immersive qualities of games, which I particularly find with role-playing games, and I love about games. But I also have sometimes get a bit fascinated just by the maths and kind of statistics and things. And so the dice and the way that the dice work in a Blackstone Fortress was a lot of fun, I found. I was interested in having some special dice, and what I found was that the D6, the D8, the D12, and the way that they kind of like worked within the game, the maths of it was fantastic. It was I had all kinds of fun. I had spreadsheets, and things. It allowed me to do quite a lot of stuff while at the same time being quite an entertainingly tactile thing to do. And then finally, within the we'd got the story, because we've got the miniatures, and the miniatures were awesome. But they were quite an eclectic little group of miniatures. Basically, the miniature designers had backstories for each of the individual models, why exactly they were all hanging out together and going somewhere to do something. It was a little bit less clear. We got our heads together and started coming up with a background. And I think that I only worked on the first stage. I worked on the initial game, and then again I had to get back to working on Age of Sigmar and hand the baton on there. I knew what the story was going to be because we'd mapped all of that out. And so it's been very exciting watching the expansions coming out, knowing what's going to come next and stuff. So that side of again of working on this big backstory and it being a story that wasn't about huge armies fighting each other. It was about the stuff, say, in the shadows, these kind of little small groups of people, but with potentially galaxy-alterating implications for what was going on there. Was very exciting. Then I got to incorporate some of it into the game and have envelopes that you opened and a little secret reveals as best we could to try and kind of like get that sense of drama into the game as you were playing it, and hopefully kind of like the sense of you're actually participating in quite a big story.
There was a sense of drama. great sense of drama and participating. We played a few games of Blackstone Fortress on Warhammer Live over the course of the last year, and it was, yeah, we got quite carried away, and people were leaning into the characters a little bit. Yeah. We still can't find how to kill the Eldar in the group. There were three good, righteous Imperial humans, and we couldn't kill the alien. We couldn't find the rules that would allow us to do this, but we were playing in character as we saw it. But yeah, I used to play Warhammer Quest in a similar style, because the game engine, the rule system supported you moving around, but the interactions, the conversations you'd have, and likewise if there was a kind of games master who had a bit of a plan, they could make that very entertaining.
You know, the banter, I think, is and yeah, well, I'm thinking one of the when you're working designing a game like that, Blackstone Fortress, it calls for a huge amount of playtesting. Yeah, so our little dedicated group of playtesters, we were playing, you know, most lunchtimes, to be honest, for months, really, to work our way through all of the different things that could happen within the game. But one of the, all the different characters, trying to make sure that each character had their niche, a little role to, an interesting thing to be able to do. But the thing I remember as much as anything is the people laughing at being funny, ridiculous stuff that happens. The character that just spent most of their time just kind of like rushing forward, getting knocked over and hanging on by the skin of their teeth to get back up and then finally to win the day, basically. All kinds of stuff like that is a great part of the game. And I think that, you know, that opportunity to be brave. Yeah, I think there's a thing that you can do in role-playing games, because you care about the character quite a lot, and in the end you start worrying about them. Yeah, and you don't really want them to die, even though it's a game and it might be the best way to win. So that kind of love, but sometimes you've got to, for the good of the party, and so actually you end up thinking, oh, what a hero. and sometimes you hear authors talking about when the characters in their books seem to have a life of their own. And that definitely happens with role-playing games. Sometimes you just feel, well, I'm just saying what they say. It's like, actually, I really don't have a huge amount of control over this. I know what they're going to do. And then you just have to do it. Basically, that's the way that you have to do it. And I love that kind of aspect of role-playing games. And I think, the Warhammer Quest series is an opportunity for us to kind of like scratch that itch, while at the same time having Citadel miniatures for all the pieces and things that you're using in the game, and just the look of the boards and all the artwork and stuff. It really exciting stuff.
A little similar to Warcry, is it a conscious decision with all the Warhammer Quest games since the original Warhammer Quest? Warhammer Quest was set in a dungeon under the old world, very recognisable sort of dungeon bash in the Warhammer world, and all of the settings of the later Warhammer Quest games have been things we've not really had any handle on at all. We've never been inside a Silver Tower, we've never been to the Blackstone Fortress, even Hammerhall. We've never seen the shadows under Hammerhall or over Hammerhall. We've never been to Hammerhall. Was it a conscious decision to allow the creatives making the game a bit more freedom to build up these worlds?
Yeah, I think it just came naturally, to be perfectly honest, because once you've done a dungeon, then you kind of you want to bring something new to the game. Shadows was an interesting project to work on, because it allowed us to really start to say, well, how does a Sigmarite city work? And again, how do these people live together? How do they interact? So although quite a lot of it's in the dungeons under the streets, the background for it really explored the city and that place. Again, for me, that kind of like nodded back to my early experience with role-playing games, because the city adventures, I remember there was a magnificently titled City State of the Invincible Overlord that I had when I was about 14 or 15, which was a city on these huge pieces of paper, and you could wander around and have encounters in the city. So the city bit, and as always for me, been an important part of role-playing games. And Shadows really explored that. I think Blackstone Fortress, it starts to kind of like look at some of the edges of the Imperium, what's happening, like away from the centre, away from the big battlefields, in these sort of the nooks and crannies of the Imperium. And obviously it gave us this whole kind of thing about what are the Blackstone Fortresses about. you know, what's going on with those, and look at some of the characters and things that we couldn't really, we're never going to be able to do a whole army of things like that, but we're aware of them within the background. So I think that you naturally look towards something interesting new to explore, because you know that that's interesting for you, and you know that it'll make it an interesting game for the people who play it when we actually bring it out. And so there doesn't need to be terribly much guidance. it's natural, just a natural thing to do.
Very nice. I've seen a number of people with the kind of growth of games and the hobbies and people coming up with new ways to play with Citadel miniatures for themselves. One of the things I remember seeing, people playing Warhammer Underworlds with Warhammer 40,000 miniatures, and they were using Thousand Suns Exalted Sorcerers as the storm-sized curse breakers. I think the Stormcast Eternal Wizards, because you looked at them and went, they've got armor, they've got staffs, they cast spell. Yeah. That would work within the paradigm of that game engine wonderfully. And I do wonder if, in the absence of a fantasy dungeon-bashing game, if there are people who are liberating the Blackstone Fortress rule set, or have looked at it askance and wondered, could you put some Age of Sigmar models in there and go role playing around?
I would certainly hope so. You know, I really would, because to be honest, the reason I do this job is because that's what I used to do. You know, when I started out gaming, there weren't terribly many fantasy and science fiction games around, but I loved fantasy and science fiction. So in particular, I can remember I had a set of war games rules that allowed you to fight gladiatorial combats, because you could get historical war games rules then, but not really fantasy and science fiction ones, which was great. I used to enjoy those. It was a nice little skirmish game. But I loved Conan. So what I did was I took those gladiatorial combat rules and I made my Conan game out of them. And made up rules, you know, like Conan obviously super human, so I had to invent rules from being able to knock people back. So if you try to parry him with your shield, then quite likely you'd end up flying backwards 6 feet or something. And I needed monsters in there because I had a giant spider model, and I needed to get that into the game somehow or another. So I made up rules for it. So you know, the job that I do now is just a continuation of that, and so it just seems the natural thing for me to do, and I enjoy it so much that I really would hope that people would, if they're looking at Blackstone Fortress and saying, wouldn't it be cool if I could use this model in the game, saying, but it should be easy. Well, I'm just going to do that. I'm going to make up the rules for it, because you can. Nobody's going to stop you, least of all us. And it will be great fun, yeah, which is really... What more reason do you need?
That's the heart of it. I talked to Chris Peach recently for one of the podcasts, and he's been collecting Warcry warbands and converting Slaaneshi cultists from all sorts of crazy sources, and then he was looking over the rules, trying to get a sense of what would he like to count them as, because he's not going to write new rules. We understand how much work goes into writing and refining and making semantically correct and playtesting the rules, so to use that existing framework of rules, but just change what some of the descriptive words are or the background words are, seems like a sensible way to get involved. And he was looking over the Warcry abilities, and he was trying to think what would he want his models to do in the game, and then he found the most appropriate fit and kind of retrofitted the descriptions to suit that. And that seems like a good steer. I think if you want to feel like something is happening in the game, something is taking place in the world or somewhere in the mortal realms, find something that does something similar to that and use some different miniatures maybe, or try it out that way.
Well, absolutely. And it's usually very easy to use counts as rules. I think particularly when you're doing it for the right reasons and stuff, because you've got some great models that you want to be able to use in a game. In my experience, people are very excited to give you the opportunity to do it. They want to see the models down and be able to play the game too. And then I think that's also a natural springboard to kind of like going, well, wouldn't it be even better if? And then before you know it, you're a games designer.
There seems to be quite an element of the sort of zero-sum abilities in Warhammer Age of Sigmar. It doesn't have the same concern with the granularity of points values that Warhammer 40,000 traditionally has. So with command traits and an awful lot of the sub-faction abilities, you know you're getting one. So it feels like there is, if you're playing a legal army, you'll be battle-forged and you'll be eligible for one of these sorts of bonuses. And with a trait, D6 command traits, you'll have six abilities to pick from, it does feel like there's an element of just, it's fine, don't worry too much about the detail. So if you were compelled or inspired to come up with some rules, start with a best fit and then maybe play around, experiment with what you already have, but it probably won't be too prescriptive.
No, absolutely. And I think things like that, they work particularly well if you've got a group of friends playing, and they work particularly well if you're going to set up a little campaign or some kind of backstory to it. I think sometimes when I talk to people, they'll say, oh, well, my friends will never agree because I've made the rules up myself. And I say, well, one easy way around that is don't, whatever you're making the rules up for, don't use it yourself. Say, I've made the rules up. Will you try it out for me? So you let them have the opportunity, because then, it's not like you're trying to get some strange advantage out of these powerful rules that you've done. And to be honest as well, being on the receiving end of the what you consider to be the amazing rules that you've come up with can be a salutary lesson, and will quickly lead you to kind of like modifying them and making things a little bit better. So I think there are lots of ways that you can kind of like go along that path. But at the heart of it is that kind of the creative side of the hobby. The hobby is creative on a number of different levels. Making the models, converting them, painting them, putting together an army, coming up with a backstory for the army, and all of the rest of it. As much as possible, I think players should try to be as unrestrained as they feel comfortable within that. And try out stuff. The worst that can happen is that you have a game that's not all that satisfying, and you go, well, that wasn't a terribly good idea, let's move on, and let's just play with the standard rules if that's what you feel that you need. But do try things out. The next time somebody comes along and says, I've come up with some cool rules, do you mind if I use them? The answer should always be yes. Yeah. Of course, I'd love to. Yeah.
But maybe try them against the person who's created them, just to give them a taste of what it was like, for full balance.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is there anything particularly you're looking forward to seeing from hobbyists in the Warhammer Age of Sigmar community in 2020?
Gosh.
Not giving anything away that you know is coming in 2020.
I know it's difficult because there's some great stuff coming up this year. That's a really interesting question, actually, because I think that what I tend to do is I'll always be looking at what we can do better and what we're doing. I think that the thing that I find most satisfying when you look out there is people being unashamedly enthusiastic about what they've been working on and showing it off with pride. Yeah, because that's one of the things that I get to see quite a lot. Obviously, as a rules writer, you end up tied up with threads asking you questions and things. But if people wanted to send through to the Age of Sigmar FAQ box, some pictures of the latest models in their army, that would be great. Stuff like that, where take pride in what you're doing, showing it off. And it's one of the reasons the open day that I worked at the weekend. I've been doing this stuff for quite a while, but I always enjoy going along to the open days because you meet people who are really enthusiastic and passionate about things that you're really enthusiastic and passionate about too. So being able for people to express that and show it, that would be great. More of that, please.
Superb. Yeah. That is a very positive note to finish on, so we will. Thank you very much, Jervis, and we'll look forward to everything that 2020 has to hold for Warhammer Age of Sigmar.
Super. Okay, thank you.
Thanks again to Jervis, and thank you for watching or listening to the podcast. StormCast will return in 2 weeks' time, and there'll be another episode of VoxCast released next week. In the meantime, you can keep up to date with details of all the shows we're making, and leave us any feedback you have about the podcasts on the Warhammer TV Facebook page. See you soon.